number 21. Then Delilah said to Samson, until now you have mocked me and told me lies. Tell me how you could be mine. He said, if you weave the seven locks of my neck with the web and make it tight with the pin, then I shall become weak and be like anyone else. So while he slept, Delilah took the seven locks of his head and wove them into the web and made them tight with the pin. Then she said to him, the Philistines are upon you, Samson. But he awoke from his sleep and pulled away the pin, the loom and the web. Then she said to him, how can you say I love you when your heart is not with me? You have mocked me three times now, and I have not told you what makes your strength so great. Finally, after she nagged him at her words day after day and pestered him, he was tired to death. So he told her his whole secret and said to her, a razor has never come upon my head, for I have been a Nazarite to God from my mother's womb. If my head were shaved, then my strength would leave. I would become weak and be like anyone else. When Delilah realized that he had told his whole secret, she said and called the words of the Philistine, saying, this time come up, for he has told me his whole secret. Then the words of the Philistines came up to her and brought the money in their hands. She let him fall asleep on her lap, and she called a man and had him shave off the seven locks of his head. He began to weaken, and his strength left him. Then she said, the Philistines are upon you, Samson. When he awoke from his sleep, he thought, I will go off, as at other times, and shake myself free. But he did not know that the Lord had left him. So the Philistines seized him and gouged out his eyes. They brought him down to Gaza and bound him with bronze shackles, and he ground the meal in the prison. The word of God for the people of God.
How much of what God has given me have I wasted? You guys like baseball movies? One of my favorite baseball movies is The Natural. It's been around for a while now. There is a Robert Redford. He was the leading actor in that. The person he's portraying is a fictional movie, of course. He's portraying a 19-year-old baseball player. In the beginning, his name is Roy Hobbs. You listen to many pirate games periodically, you'll hear somebody talk about The Natural. Now, in real life, after this movie came out, Will Clark, who played for the San Francisco Giants, because he had a swing that was about as pure as a swing could be, his nickname became The Natural. It was because of this movie. But you'll hear this movie talked about on Major League Baseball sometimes. So it starts off. There's a 19-year-old baseball player right at the beginning of his career, and he's on a train, and he's heading for a tryout with the Chicago Cubs. This movie would take place probably back in the 1920s, 1930s, around in that point. And he's on this train, and there's a really famous baseball player on the train there. And it doesn't, his name isn't Babe Ruth in the movie, but that's who you think of. This guy was an incredible hitter, and he's the best hitter probably in the United States. And so the guy that's traveling with Roy Hobbs, they're going to take a stop up at this one town for a break. And he says, I tell you what, I bet my person here can throw three pitches and strike him out. If he throws a ball, then it's over. But he has to throw three strikes, and I guarantee you, he'll strike him out and never be able to hit the ball. So they get there, and Robert Redford goes out there, and of course the guy playing, looks like Babe Ruth. He's thinking, like, I'm going to hit the ball so far. This baseball's going to need, it's going to need an airline ticket. So he goes up there. Roy Hobbs, he's a lefty. He throws the ball right down the middle, and it's almost like the batter doesn't even see it. He can't believe that it just blew right by him. And so then after three pitches, on the third pitch, he strikes him out. But there's this woman. She's psychotic. She's just strange. And she's there, and she's just looking at this batter, the guy who looks like Babe Ruth. She's just watching him because she's mesmerized by him. Soon as that third pitch goes in for a strike, she just goes like this. You can see the camera. She just turns like this. Chris just like you were worried about, she's just staring right at him. Well, the next thing, they're going to be staying in this motel. And this girl, she's so pretty, she asked Roy Hobbs, this 19-year-old, he has a girlfriend at home. But here he is, he's starstruck. First time he's been away from home, and this pretty girl asked him to come up to the hotel room. And he kind of walks in, and she's dressed in all black. And she looks at him, and she says, "Are you going to be the best there's ever been?" And he says, "Yes, I'll be the best there ever was." She pulls out a gun, and she shoots him right in the belly. And that's where, and then she kills herself. She commits suicide. Later they find out this woman had been tracking famous athletes and killing them. And so she thought she was going to kill the best there ever was. Here's Roy Hobbs, incredibly talented, 19 years old. Immediately the movie goes up to where he's 35. And they're there, and there's this team called the New York Knights. It's a professional baseball team, and they're pathetic. And so the coach is there, and he's wondering, and in comes Roy Hobbs. It's Robert Redford. He's walking in as a 35-year-old now. He's a rookie. Had never played Major League ball. He just kind of shows up 16 years later. Nobody knows who he is. But he gets signed, and he gets a chance with the big leagues. And the coach looks at him and says, "I'm not going to let you play. I told the owner I need baseball players." And he sends me 35-year-old washed-up rookies. So he says, "I'll never play. You sit on the end of the bench." So he sits down here. Finally, here comes this game where he's going to let him play. And this is one of those scenes that only Hollywood could come up with. There's clouds. There's a storm brewing. And Roy Hobbs comes up to bat. And first time he's with a bat in the major leagues, a 35-year-old, he hits the ball so hard. You know, you've heard the phrase, "You're going to knock the cover off the ball." Well, he hit the ball so hard he knocked the cover off the ball. The ball simply explodes in the outfield. The cover, where it's kind of like sewn on, it's laying one place. The other part of the ball is gone, and like strings are like hanging out from it. And the outfielder goes out and he picks it up and does all this stuff, and Roy Hobbs scores. And it starts, it's raining, and everybody's wondering, like, where did this guy come from? Well, and the movie goes on. Finally, he ends up the season. Through a chain of events, he gets connected with his old girlfriend, and everybody lives happily ever after. But he has to retire after that year because of the injuries that he had because of when he was shot. Roy Hobbs, perfect example of someone who had the world as his oyster, yet he threw it all away. Kind of like Samson. Samson could have been one of the greatest men of the Bible. I mean, think about this. How many times in the Bible does an angel come and tell a woman that she's going to be pregnant? Someone who's not pregnant, tell the woman she's going to be pregnant and that her child is going to do incredibly great things. Well, God spoke to Abraham and said he's going to have a son, Isaac. That happened. John the Baptist, Jesus. It's a small list of times. There's just a handful of other ones. Just a small number of people throughout history that an angel came and said. Of all the judges in the book of Judges, the one with the most promise, if you want to say that, was Samson. Remember, we talked about last week how the angel came and told his mom, "You're going to have this child. This child's going to be a Nazarite all his life. He's going to serve the Lord, and God's going to do great things through him." Samson had a lot of potential. Now let me tell you, potential is a good bad word. Okay? If you walk up to somebody and say they have a lot of potential, there's an upside to that. You're saying, you know, you could be really good. But walk up to somebody and say, "You got a lot of potential," and it's almost a little bit of a dig, because you're telling the person, you've never done anything yet. You may have potential, but as of now, you've never done it. Because once a person's done it, nobody talks about Michael Jordan's potential. Nobody talks about Billy Graham's potential. They talk about what Michael Jordan did, what Billy Graham did. We talk about potential with people who can become something, but as of yet, they have not. Samson had a lot of potential. He had great physical strength. I mean, he one time killed a lion. Now, I remember years ago, I was at I was at a museum in Washington, D.C., at the Smithsonian, there, a natural history museum. And they had a lion, no, I'm sorry, they had a tiger that had been stuffed. It was this large tiger that had been caught in Africa from years ago. This thing was kind of stretched out, you know, with the arms, it looks like it's leaping someplace. The arms are in the front, the back legs are kind of back. I remember reading this, it was 27 feet long, stretched out. You know, when you and I think of lions and tigers and bears, we think of like a tiger as being sort of something like a little bit bigger than a kitty cat and you just knock it over. Well, let me tell you, there's a reason why when lions attack people, even if you have a gun and a knife, put your money on the lion. Okay, they've had people in Africa, actually, who have been killed by tigers who were on safaris, and there would be a tiger 100 yards away. And the people got out of their car, and they're right next to the door, 100 yards away, you think you're pretty safe. And they're so fast and so quick, the tiger charged them and actually ate them, killed them, before they were able to open up the door and get inside and shut. They're fast, they're mean, and they're deadly. Well, Samson, it says, if you, you know, one of the passages that we didn't read, Samson's not alone, and he kills a lion, barehanded, as though it says it was like a little cup, it's like a little something. He just ripped it apart. Incredible physical strength. One time he killed 30 Philistines, it says, by himself. Another place it says he killed 1,000 Philistines. Can you imagine a battle where there's 1,000 guys on one side and there's one guy on the other side? Who would you put your money on? Well, Samson killed 1,000 Philistines. He had incredible physical talent. It was unheard of. He may have been the most deadly soldier the world has ever known. Samson had incredible strength. In the same way, God has given you and I talent. And the older you are, one of the regrets that you have, and I have this regret, one of the regrets that you have, the older you become, is the things that you perhaps could have done if you would have surrendered your life to the Lord more than you did. When you're young, you still have that chance to do that. The older you become, we look back over our lives and we think, man, I wish I would have served God more faithfully. The things that I could have done, but through whatever, I wasted that time. It's one of the regrets I have in my life. How much of what God has given you and I have we wasted? You know, people who think, well, wait till I'm on my deathbed, and as long as I say, Jesus, forgive me, I want to become a Christian, and as long as I go to heaven, I've got to, quote, have, I had my cake, and I'll go to heaven, and I can eat it too, so to speak. Well, let me tell you, talk to anybody who gives their heart to the Lord later in life, one thing they will talk to you about is how I regret that I didn't serve God all of my life. Samson had ability, had lots of potential. But what was the problem that Samson had? Well, Samson had lots of ability, but he had little self-discipline. You've probably heard this phrase, too much is given, much is required. God gives you more. The parable of the talents. God gave some people 5 talents. He gave one person in that story 1-2 talents. Another person he gave 1. God doesn't expect more from you than what you're capable of. If God gives you great ability, you should do greater things because God has given you more. To whom much is given, much is required. Samson was given a lot. He was a Nazarite, so to speak, time he was born. Now sometimes we hear that phrase, a Nazarite, and we make a mistake sometimes because Jesus was he was from Nazareth, he was a Nazarene. Don't confuse Jesus being a Nazarene because he was from Nazareth. The word Nazareth or Nazarene is not the same as a Nazarite. First time you see that, here's Numbers chapter 6, verses 1-8, it goes like this. The Lord spoke to Moses saying, speak to the Israelites and say to them, when either men or women make a special vow, the vow of a Nazarite, to separate themselves to the Lord, they shall separate themselves from wine and spent strong drink. They shall drink no wine vinegar or other vinegar, and shall not drink any grape juice or eat grapes, fresh or dry. All their days as Nazarites, they shall eat nothing that is not produced by the grapevine, and even the seeds of the skins. All the days of the Nazarite vow, no razor shall come upon their head until the time is completed for which they separate themselves to the Lord. They shall be holy. They shall let the locks of their head grow long. All the days that they separate themselves to the Lord, they shall not go near a corpse. Even if their father or mother, brother or sister should die, they may not defile themselves, because their consecration to God is upon them, is upon the head. All their days as Nazarites, they are to be holy to the Lord. Now this is a vow a person would take for a given person, point of time. However, Samson was to be a Nazarite all his life. He had never cut his hair, for example. And so you see there are three things, basically, in this vow. First thing is, they weren't supposed to drink wine or grape juice, anything from grapes. They weren't supposed to have anything to do with it. Secondly, they weren't supposed to touch dead things, like people or animals. They were not supposed to come near any corpse. At the same time, they were not supposed to cut their hair. Well, in this passage, we didn't read all of it, because it was about three chapters. Samson had parties where he had alcohol, broke that one, and for him sure broke it more than once. The one story is there where after he killed the lion, later he's gone down there, the dead carcass is there, there's bees, there's some honey there, he takes the animal, opens it up, takes the honey out, and says he ate the honey as he's walking along. So he was willing to touch dead things. And I think we pretty much know about the hair issue, how he got his hair to be cut. And these are just examples of the many different times that Samson would have failed in what God commanded him to do. Now, Samson's specific area, perhaps, where he had the most trouble was, he had a weakness with women. Now, most men, that is probably, you know, I read something as I was preparing for this week. This one Christian author said this. He says, women make men dumb. And that's pretty much true. Women make men dumb. The average man, and I speak this to my own shame, because most of us, women make us dumb. The average woman could wear a shirt that says, "My name's Delilah. And if you hook up with me, I'm going to destroy your life." Most men would probably still say she's cute and think that, well, maybe that's not going to happen to me. Women make men dumb. That's what one author said this week. It's kind of funny, but there's probably some truth to that. Now, previously, God had told the Israelites they were not to intermarry with foreign people. Men weren't supposed to marry foreign women, and Israelite women weren't supposed to marry foreign men. And there was a reason for that. It's not because God didn't love the Philistines or the Amorites or any of the others. It's not that God didn't love them. It's that God was creating a holy people, because it was through the people of Israel that Jesus Christ was going to be born. And Jesus was not only going to save the Israelites, he was going to save everybody. But God wanted a people that was pure. And so he said no intermarriages, because he knew what would happen was they would adopt the gods of these foreign people. Rather than these people becoming Jews, so to speak, the Israelites would become like these foreign people. And so Samson already knew that he wasn't supposed to mess around with foreign women. But we see in Judges 14, verses 1 and 3. Once Samson went down to Timnah. In Timnah, he saw a Philistine woman. Now right away, you know, this wasn't Delilah, this was another woman, because there was a number of women. Delilah simply happened to be the last one. There were a number of women there. And these were, he knew it was a Philistine woman. He would have known she is off limits. So verse 2, then he came up and told his father and mother, "I saw a Philistine woman in Timnah. Now get her for me as my wife." But his father and mother said to him, "Is there not a woman among your kin or among all our people that you must go to take a wife from the uncircumcised Philistines?" But Samson said to his father, now listen to this, we wonder how this guy, how he could be so foolish. He says, "Get her for me, because she pleases me." He had never talked to her. He didn't know anything about her family other than the fact she was a Philistine. She was good looking, and that was good enough for Samson. Because she looked pleasing to him, he wants to marry her. I mean, you know, he's never had a conversation with her, he never had coffee with her, never went out to Red Lobster, nothing. He just wanted her because she was good looking. Samson was totally going to disobey God. This girl's gorgeous, and that's good enough for Samson. The foreign woman, this Philistine woman, would have had foreign gods. God says, well, boy, I'm not married. What does Samson do? He wants this girl. Now, right now, I'm going to step apart from Samson. I'm going to talk to some of you guys. If you're married, you don't need to listen to me right now. You can sort of, like, you know, check your phone and see what's going on with your friends on Facebook. You can do that for a minute. Don't do that. But you can do that just for about a minute emotionally. I'm talking specifically to the single people here right now. And this advice, if you obey my advice, guaranteed, when you make $1 million, you'll give about your first time $1,000 to me if you follow this advice. This is how valuable this is. If you're single, don't date non-Christian girls or boys. Period. Don't even date. My sister, Montaigne, she told me this years ago. She says, here's my advice on dating. And I said, okay. She said, it's real simple. She said, you only marry people that you date. And I've kind of shared this before, but there's so much truth to this. Think about this if you're married. How many people did you date before you were married? And I've asked some of you this question before. How many people did you date? Let's say you dated 4 people before you got married, and your husband or your wife was your 51. So I'd say to you, so every time you go out with somebody on a first date, you have a 20% chance of marrying them. If you think of it that way, first dates really matter. If it's a 1 out of 5 shot, I mean, how would you like it? You have a dice with, you know, 1 through 6, and you're going to go out with a girl and from a blind date, and you roll the dice, and it comes up a 4. This is the girl you marry and spend the rest of your life with and raise a family with. I mean, that would make first dates seem a whole lot more scary, so to speak. You only marry people that you date. That's what my sister says, was if you want to marry a good one, you only date good ones. Because out of that pile of people, so to speak, people you date, one of those will become your spouse. I have talked to numerous people in my years as a pastor who has come to me and says, I wish I could go back. Because they married somebody outside of their faith. They thought that they could bring this person to the Lord. And I'll use this word, that's a bunch of hogwash. Most likely what will happen is they will have you become like them rather than them become a Christian like you. It'll happen occasionally. As a professor of mine once says, it happens once in a while, but it doesn't happen twice in a while. And so my point is, only date Christians, because it's out of those, if you date them, you will marry one of them, perhaps, and you will regret that. And so, Samson's parents are doing everything they can do. Wouldn't you like to find a nice girl who lives here and has the same faith that you do? Get her for me. She pleases me. And I'm sure that some of you parents have probably at times kind of told your son or daughter, like, you know, I know those girls at the party are cute, but you know, you could find a really nice boy at church. Or you could find a really nice girl at church. No better place to find someone. So, those of you who are single, only date Christians. You will never regret that decision. But back to Samson. Here's a few things about Samson that he had trouble with. Number one, he was impulsive. Lust, anger, whatever it is. Samson was ready to go. He didn't really think about things too much. Whatever impression came to his mind, poof, away he went. And he got in trouble with that. It says in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, live by the Spirit. I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh, because let me tell you, if you do, you do so at your own peril. Being impulsive and not obeying God will destroy you. The second thing was Samson. Now, Samson was, he was compromising. He was willing to live with sin. Do not do that, my friends. It will destroy you. The third thing that Samson was, he was unteachable and was a loner. I trust, and I've mentioned this a few times recently because God's really laying this upon my heart to share this. You need to have people in your life that you trust spiritually. You need to have people in your life that if you look them in the face, they will tell you the truth about who you are because they love you. They're not out to hurt you. They're out to help you. Samson's parents went to him, and he would listen to them. He was going to do what he was going to do, even if it destroyed him, and it did. The fourth thing was he was proud. Samson had this impression, I'm a strong guy. I can do pretty much what I want. Nobody could stop me. Nobody could hurt me. Even in that thing, after he had his hair cut, he thought to himself, it'll be just like the other times when the Philistines come upon me. I'll simply jump up and take care of them. But at that point, he couldn't deal with a lion, so to speak. He couldn't even deal with a kitty cat. A little bit of strength would have got him down. He had lost his power because he thought that he was strong. Because he was strong. He was strong because God's Spirit was upon him. Once God's Spirit left him, nobody. And so, that's about Samson. What about you and I? What are the weak areas in our life? Because let me tell you, we all have them. It says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance race that is set before us. And so sin will cling to us, but there is always that sin that seems like it will affect us more than it will affect somebody else. For Samson, it was women and sex. And for some men and women, that's what their weakness is. But that's not a weakness every person has. Some people, it's a matter of drugs. Some people, it's a matter of alcohol. Some people, it's a matter of ambition. Some people, it's they have hobbies that dominate them, that their hobbies matter more than anything else or anyone else. Some people, it's placing their families before God, that somehow their spouse, their children, is even ahead of God in their list of priorities. And as good as that sounds, putting your family and your spouse first. Your spouse and your family shouldn't be first. God should be first. In fact, if you put God first, you end up loving them more than the person who doesn't do that. The person who wants what they want more than what God wants for them. All of us have that area where we are naturally weak. It's different for every one of us. You know, I don't drink alcohol. There's been very few times in my life where I've taken a drink of alcohol. I grew up in a family. I've never seen my mother or father when they were alive. I never saw either of them. I saw my brother Tommy or my sister Monty never take a drink. I never tasted alcohol or beer or anything until I was 34 years of age. Okay, I don't drink. You could take me into a bar, you could give me free alcohol forever, and I would have no trouble whatsoever. But take me to a McDonald's buffet and have Big Macs there, as many as you could eat, and you'd have to will me out in. I mean, I need about 17 of them. That's what I would tell you. Because I would have no willpower whatsoever. And I would look at that person that perhaps has gambled their life away. And I wonder to myself, how could they possibly do that? While I'm sitting there eating my 17th Big Mac. All of us, the reason I say that is all of us have our area. And right now you're probably thinking of that. People may know about it. People may not. But whatever your area is of weakness, that area will kill you eventually. There will come a circumstance where that area will be bigger to you than what God is. You and I need to overcome, through God's help, whatever our weak areas are. You know, Samson's a tragedy. As I mentioned, he could have been one of the biggest names in the Bible. Instead, we see how Samson ends up there at verse number 31. There's more to Samson's story. We'll talk about that next week. But there in verse 21, as Carol Carol read for us the last part of that. They put out Samson's eyes, and he is there. They put shackles on him, and he's kind of like an oxen, so to speak. You know, when he's round kind of things where he's like walking around, and they're grinding, he's grinding the grain there, like it's a big meal, so to speak. That's where Samson ends up at. It's this horrible story. He threw it all away. He had all of this promise, all of this potential, and he threw it away because his weaknesses overcame him. God has given you and I so much. Do you and I use that for him, or do we throw that away? You know, what are the weakest areas that you have? It says in this closing, it says in Matthew 5:29-30, if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. Now, I don't think what God's saying there is cut your eye out. And I don't think what God's saying there is cut your hand off. He's not saying that. What God's talking about is to be ruthless. He's using that as an example. Be ruthless with removing sin from your life. That little bit of sin that you think, it's just a little white lie. It's just a little thing. Everybody does that kind of stuff. It's not going to hurt me. It will kill you eventually. Because you ever notice people, yeast into bread, just a little bit of yeast causes a bunch of bread to expand. A little bit of sin will expand in your life and cause all kinds of bad things to happen. Be ruthless. Can you imagine if Samson would have listened to his dad, or he would have found a girl from across town who was a Jewish girl? The story would have been different. But Samson didn't do that. And sadly, most of the time I have fallen as well. And if we're honest, let's you and I be ruthless in removing sin from our lives. Almighty God, we love you. Forgive me for what I have thrown away. Forgive each of us for what we have thrown away. All of us were born to be more than just we were born to be more than just somebody who lives their life in a haphazard way. You've given each one of us so much. Help us to use it for you. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray.
I follow the heart.
I stopped at verse number 21, and there's a verse right after it that is where we'll be speaking, and where I'll be speaking about next Sunday, and with the end of Samson's life. Verse 21 is an end. It's really bad. Samson gets his eyes put out. He's grinding up a grain, so to speak. Bad things. But the Philistines, if they would have had any sense at all, they would have shaved his head every day. Because in verse 22 it says, but God had the hair on Samson's head start to grow back. And so even as Samson was there each day grinding the grain, his hair was growing and God was being merciful. Because let me tell you, today's sermon, if you just take what I said today without next week, it kind of sounds like you mess up, you just wasted it, that's it. But God is merciful and God is forgiving. And what God did in Samson's life, God can do in anybody's life. No matter how much you've messed up, no matter how much you've taken what God has given you and thrown away a number of times, the God we serve is forgiving and the God we serve is full of grace. Samson's hair started to grow back, and as we look at next week, you'll see where Samson cries out for God's help, and God gives him his strength back. And Samson, though his life had some bad things, there's a reason why in the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews, we refer to often as the faith chapter, Samson's name is in there, not as someone who failed, but as someone who believes God can take the part of us that messes up and God can change us into the person we desire. For you, for me, for anybody, no matter how bad they've messed up, we serve a merciful and forgiving God. But my friends, you go today, you and I have any habits, weaknesses, whatever, that keeps us from serving God, but surrender everything to the Lord. My friends, go at peace, knowing that God is bigger than your failures, bigger than your problems, and he has a